would like to point out one typographical error, if I could, on page 2.
I didn't hear a second. Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Discussion.
There's a mention of a Mr. McKay, and I believe that should be Ms.
Sorry. Thank you.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of accepting the planning board meetings with that one change, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous vote. Thank you. Correspondence this evening. I received a letter dated December 5th, 1991 from Richard Davis. In reply to a letter to him, evidently from the town, advising us he didn't think that our action taken by the planning board was in accordance with the Superior Court decision, but that he is not going to pursue that any further. The second piece of correspondence is an article copied for us, I believe, by Maureen. I've already heard a couple of comments, interesting article, titled The Two Cultures of Planning Toward the New Pragmatism. Any other correspondence to board members? Okay. The first order of business, of old business, Stonegate Phase 4 subdivision, request by Recall Management to extend the time period for preliminary subdivision plan review of a 17-lot subdivision located off Stonegate Road, Section 16-2-4A8. As I have in the past, as an officer of Recall Management, I have to recuse myself from participating, and I'll appoint Judith Kane to the chair.
Ms. Chair, my firm represents Recall Management on occasion, so I would also like to recuse myself from consideration of this matter.
Okay. In which case, I am going to appoint Judy Lardner and Tim Eichenberg, voting members for this. Is there anyone here representing Recall? Stonegate? In which case, why don't I, for the benefit of the viewing public, read the letter from Frederick Licht on behalf of Stonegate, dated December 2nd. Dear Ms. O'Meara and members of the Planning Board, acting on behalf of Recall Management, Inc., I would like to formally request an extension of the Planning Board review of all the Stonegate Phase 4 application for preliminary subdivision approval and wetland special permit to be tabled until the regular January 1992 meeting. This request is being made to allow time for Recall to adequately prepare additional materials requested by the board and which are required for approval. Thank you for your cooperation. I think that the letter is pretty self-explanatory. Is there any discussion from the board? In which case, do we have a motion? Judy?
Close the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that, based on the request submitted by Stonegate Associates and Fleet Bank, the applications for preliminary plan review, a wetlands alteration permit under the pre-May 90 provisions, and a permit for construction in a resource protection district under the pre-May 90 provisions for Stonegate Phase 4, a 17-lot major subdivision located off of Stonegate Road, be tabled to the January 1992 Planning Board meeting with the mutual agreement of both the applicants and the Planning Board.
A second?
Second.
Any discussion? The only question I have is that it would be mutual agreement and the applicant isn't here. Do you have anything to add?
Well, the applicant did originally make the request.
For that?
I think the letter would stand.
Okay. All those in favor? None opposed. It's passed. And I welcome Mr. Etzel back to his chair.
Thank you, Judith. Next order of business under old business, Tinsman Fitness Center, request by Thomas Tinsman for the site plan review of a conversion of approximately 1,000 square feet of space from office use to a fitness center, public hearing, section 19-2-9. I give it okay that you'll be joining us. I'll ask that Judy Lardner stay on as a voting member for this article. I guess before the applicant comes to the podium, just to bring us up to date, this issue, this article has been before us before, was approved, or I should say the application was deemed complete with, or conditionally complete, the conditions weren't met. It was tabled last month, and we have received additional information since that time. I guess at this time, the procedure would be go over the completeness issue, then based upon an approval for completeness, then we would proceed with a public hearing, and at that time, open it up to a public hearing, then upon the closure of that, start discussion on the site plan review itself. So I see Mr. Tinsman here, if you'd like to approach the podium and just give us a brief synopsis of where you are.
Thank you very much. My name's Tom Tinsman. I'm the owner of the property at 349 Ocean House Road. I wanted to apologize for the request for the tabling at the November meeting. I made a mistake. I thought I had until that meeting to bring the material, and that was my mistake. I didn't read Maureen's letter close enough to know that I was supposed to have that in before that. So I apologize for that, and I appreciate you putting it on this month's meeting. I would like to just say a few things about the project and get whatever feedback or comments you have. Basically, as you know from the material already submitted, that it is a very, very small scale project that is basically replacing space that's already been approved for office space. Most of the requirements for a fitness center are the same as an office space. Number of parking spots, and really basically nothing else is changing. There are 15 marked parking spaces in the parking lot. Not the 10 that was in the material that was here tonight. And as I'm aware of, I think only 11 parking spaces are required from the square footage, so we seem to have adequate parking space there. I'm not sure if you want me to go on with some of the things or just answer some questions that you might have on some issues.
I think at this point, unless you have any other introduction, we'll go move right to the completeness. Issue with the board. I just remind the board that this is not a discussion of technical merit of the application. It is simply a review of the completeness of the application that we're voting on first. I guess we typically or quite often have Maureen guide us through the completeness issue. I would just like to say that there seem to be some additional, we received correspondence last month from a representative of the abutter and also from Ernest McVeigh, our code enforcement officer, pertaining to the previous site plan approval of October 17th, 1989, and that some of the items of that approval have yet to be approved. Fully met. According to the Ernest McVeigh memorandum, the 12 rhododendron depicted on the plan south of the driveway have not been planted. A length of fence south of the driveway extending to an Ocean House Road, which has not been installed. You have, I think, addressed the parking spaces, which was the third condition. We'll get to that later. Perhaps, Maureen, if you could take us down through the... I might urge the planning board members, if you have a copy of the November 19th memorandum, where there's a motion for the board to consider, which listed some of the conditions originally.
That list is also in the meeting minutes for the October meeting. But the board did vote at the October meeting to approve the application complete, conditioned upon the submission of the following items. One is the submission of sanitary waste generation information, which I believe the applicant has submitted. The town engineer has spoken to me rather than writing a letter, and has said that the information is now adequate. The applicant has revised his plans and eliminated the showers in the basement, which seem to be causing some problems in terms of ability, I think, to get sufficient water into the building rather than to get rid of it. Secondly, a letter from the water district has been submitted by the applicant. With that change in the facilities in the basement, the water district has written a letter, and they have no problem with what's being proposed. Third, a sketch of how signage for the fitness facility will be incorporated into the existing sign and the location of the sign on the site plan. That has been added with the most recent submission of information. A copy of the deed indicating the title to the property and a property line survey indicating property line bearings on the site plan. A copy of the deed has been submitted, and the property line bearings match the description on the site plan. It's up to the board if they want to request any additional information. At the October meeting, there was some discussion about...
Excuse me, Maureen. In my packet, I only got the first page of that deed. Was the total deed submitted?
Should be on the back.
I received the back.
I have two pages here. I'd be happy to...
Okay.
I guess I take it we would assume that TMT Inc. is Tom Tinson, also known as TMT Inc.
And the final item that was required as part of the completeness issue was the width of the driveway at the right-of-way line depicted on the site plan and the offset from the nearest property line. And that appears to have also been submitted with the information.
My question on the width of, it didn't seem to be at the right-of-way. It was unclear. It seems to show 13 feet on, width of the right-of-way, the driveway at the right-of-way. It states, it shows it back probably at approximately 50 feet back from the right of way. That seems to be less of an issue as far as the width of the driveway than does the offset of the nearest property line, which shows 13 feet back about 40 feet. But that seems to be a line that does become narrow as it approaches the road. Is that where the applicant took the measurement? Is back by the house, the distance from the property line?
On the 43 feet, that was measured from the house. The 13 feet was measured from the tar driveway that was existing when I purchased the property.
I realize that, but the section of our ordinance and the condition both state at the point of right-of-way, I take it means the right of town right of way. That was where it meets the street. That's the measurement that we're interested in. It's a minor issue also that the plan that I have shows 45 feet setback of the house, and then this additional plan which we just received this past month shows 43 feet. There's a 2-foot discrepancy there. I think it was Mr. Emery that brought up the issue of setback from the nearest property line of the driveway. He's not here tonight. Did you happen to take a measurement at the right-of-way, at the street, the distance offset from the property line to your driveway?
I don't understand what you're talking about. I don't see a 43 from the right-of-way.
No, you mentioned the 43. That's a setback or the side setback of your home.
Right.
Or the building to the property line. The question they have, let's say the width of the driveway at the right-of-way seems to be less of an issue. That's 18 feet. Appears to be parallel lines there. That's
yes.
What I'm saying. The second half of that is the offset of the driveway from the nearest property line, which I take it to mean the distance from the abutter, in this case to the south, to your driveway line. It's supposed to be more than 10 feet according to the ordinance. I'm just trying to confirm that it is at least that. If you want to just...
I can see where the 13 feet is, and I think that was measured right where the front of the house comes across.
What would that same measurement be if you were right at the intersection of the driveway and the road and tried to measure the distance between the edge of the tarmac and the property line?
I'm not sure. I would only be guessing that it would be around 10 feet. But when that was discussed under the original site plan, that was taking the existing driveway that was already there, and we expanded the driveway to widen it towards the building when we did that. I didn't install that driveway.
No, I realize that, but the question is, that's what's supposed to be depicted on the plan, is it's offset from the side boundary, the distance from the abutting line, in this case from the, to the south, to the edge of the driveway at the right-of-way, or was it the municipal right-of-way, and what that distance is. I don't believe it shows. Do you have also any dimensions of you have the sign just placed in the middle of the lawn, any distances to place it on the plan itself?
No.
I realize that the planning board has the right and the leeway to waiver some of the requirements of a site plan review. I guess it's my intent, I know it's Mr. Emery's intent, to try to bring this plan to a reasonable level of readability.
The sign was installed where it was originally proposed to be and requested by the planning board at that time. I didn't see anything in the material I would have gotten measurements on it. I didn't see that as a request.
I'll refrain from some questions right now. Any other board members questions on the application?
Yes, Mr. Tinsman, I have one. I'd like to know why the site plan improvements that were called for in the October 1989 determination by this board have not been complied with to date. That disturbs me quite a lot.
Well, all of the things are in now, but originally when I got the site plan approval for the real estate office, it was winter, the ground was frozen, and at that time I had mentioned that I was going to put those in by the following summer. I did not get to those. I forgot about them. Was trying to run a business and we got very busy and I just forgot about them.
And when did it come to your attention that you had forgotten about them?
I received a letter from a representative of the neighbors, and Ernie McVain, the code enforcement officer, mentioned it to me.
And when was that?
I'm not
roughly,
sure.
Roughly.
Probably a year afterwards. And at that time I put in the fence, started putting in the parking signs, and I, at that time too, I also didn't get to the plantings because those weren't mentioned. I wasn't even aware of the plantings. I mean, that was just something that was drawn in on the original site plan and got included material. I was aware of the fence and the parking markers as being the major issues.
I may misunderstand the facts. I thought there was still an issue about not only plantings, but fencing that had not yet been done.
They are all in right now.
Is that correct?
I went out to the site this afternoon with the code enforcement officer, and the plantings have been put in now, but there is still a length of fence. There has been some fencing put in, and there has been some improvement, but there is some fence that still has to be put in.
Is that something you disagree with?
Well, I guess I do in a way. I was told in this material here, and I think you have a copy of the letter, that a section of fence was missing. I put in another section of fence, and I thought that was all that was required. When I talked with Ernie McVain this afternoon, he said, well, I didn't mean one section, I meant a section of fence needed to be elongated. When the letter came out to me, it said a section of fence, so I put a section of fence in. There's 9 sections of fence there that completely covers the whole parking lot. Plus, I wasn't aware that, and I'm still not sure exactly how much more fence they want put in. But the fencing that's up does block all of the parking area with a little bit of over.
Does it match the fencing representation that's on the plan that was approved in October of 89?
It's where the fence was supposed to be, yes.
Are they rhododendrons that you planted?
Yes.
When did you plant them?
They were planted a couple of weeks ago.
Any idea what the likelihood that they'll survive?
Quite good.
Okay.
They were done by a professional. Knew what he was doing.
Other questions?
Are you still on completeness?
Yes, on the completeness issues.
As I understand it, there were 5, the application was tentatively deemed complete with 5 conditions, which Maureen's recommendation is that all 5 conditions have been met.
Yeah, that's it.
I guess I'd like some clarification. I guess I whenever anything is found conditionally complete, and then the conditions aren't met, I thought that wiped away the completeness. You indicate that we don't need to take it to a vote again.
This is a brand new procedure.
I think we should take it to a vote.
If the board feels that they want to review the conditions, that is entirely in your prerogative, since that's your original motion. I'm not aware of any motion that's ever been made for something to be conditionally complete. Usually it's just a yes or a no. So.
I would just say that I think the reason I'm deliberating over it, it's frustrating to go through approving a site plan and not have those requirements of a site plan met, and then come back on top of that same site plan and expect to handle those without those being completed, which those of us coming to the board tonight, I didn't know that Maureen had been to the site. There's nothing indicated in anything that I had read previous to the coming here tonight that these other items had been completed. Jenny, you mentioned that you'd like to see it go to a vote.
I think since it's an unusual procedure, we might as well be formal about it rather than informal. So.
Mm-hmm. Is that consensus? Any other feeling? Would you like to take it to vote, or you just want to confirm the application being complete? Any sense?
I'd like to vote.
Okay. Any other discussion? Tim?
Yeah, I have a question on the second page of the staff report where the memorandum, under buffering, it says that some of the plantings and other site improvements have not been made as of this writing, and the writing is dated December 17th. We're just informed that everything's been taken care of.
When I write these memos, I usually put the date of the planning board meeting on them, so it was written a week ago, last Wednesday.
Okay.
And as of that time, I had not gone and inspected the site again, and as far as I was aware, these things hadn't been done. As of this afternoon, there's still a length of fence that has not been completed, but the other plantings have been done. And I guess I would like to point out to the board that all of these things are on the current plan that you're considering tonight.
The one that was attached to the materials?
Mm-hmm. Actually, the one you originally received and the one that was attached to the materials.
I guess just, not to beat a dead horse, the standards that I'm accustomed to seeing, I don't think are met in this case, and it disturbs me to some extent. Whether it's a question of completeness or just a standard that I would expect to be met, I think is the question.
I think, Maureen, your comment of the most, you said of the most current plan that we have, I have a plan dated September 4th. Is that our most current plan for the approval of this application?
The plan that you received for the October 17th meeting, which should have a date in the corner that is September 4th, that's the most recent plan, plus any amendments to that plan, which would be in the package that you got for this meeting, pretty much that photocopy and the sketches of the site of the sign.
I guess just operationally, how do these things get onto whatever plan we approve? Just in the form of amendments to a motion?
I would assume that any plans you have in front of you with revisions, that the revisions would supersede the existing plan. It's not unusual for the board, especially with a major subdivision, to get a huge roll of plans and then only those sheets that have changes to be subsequently revised. So when you make your final motion for approval, you're not approving just those last four pages that you may have gotten that have been revised, but you're approving everything you've gotten with the assumption it's the most recent drawing. So I would, because the drawing you have in tonight's package is incomplete, it's only an 8.5 by 11 sheet, I would assume that any approval you make would be that 8.5 by 11 sheet plus the site plan that's the blue sheet that you have, that's the regular 2 by 3 size plan. Any discrepancies between the photocopy and the blue sheet would defer to the photocopy because that's more recent. If the board is uncomfortable with that, it's not unusual to place some kind of condition that any approval you make is recorded on a final site plan that depicts all of the conditions.
If there's no other discussion, it's consensus of the board to take the completeness issue to a vote. Do I hear a motion? Or do we need help? We're usually helpless when we don't have it already written for us. I realize that.
Well, to get it started, I will move that the application be deemed complete.
It has been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and second. Is there further discussion? Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Thank you, Mr. Tinsman. Just have a seat and we'll return after the public hearing. At this point in time, I'd like to open this application up for a public hearing. Give the members of the public a chance to address issues of concern, comments about the application. Ask you just simply keep your comments specifically to this application. I sense we have somebody approaching the podium who'd like to speak at the public hearing. Could you please identify yourself and address the board?
My name is Richard Blake. I live at Ivy Road in Cape Elizabeth and represent Constant Riche, who owns the property next door to Mr. Tinsman. I guess I'm the only public here tonight. We have a few comments. We are here to, in an attempt to stop Mr. Tinsman's development of his project. We just want to see that it's done well, done timely, and that the things that are included in any approval are carried through. Tom and I have talked a couple of times about this. We were going to do a joint inspection of the property. Unfortunately, we were doing that Friday night that it poured, so we postponed it, and we're never able to get back together. I have walked the property with the Riches, talked to the tenants who are inhabiting the property, and would like to express their concerns. The overall concern is that that property is residential in nature. Hopefully, when the town center concept is expanded, the zoning will be expanded. Mrs. Riche contemplates retiring there sometime in the future. It's a property that's meaningful to her. It's been in her family for an extended period of time. I don't know how long, over 100 years, I think. So it has a lot of emotional importance to her. Listening to Tom, one of the things we'd like to add to my list tonight is we would like to see a survey, at least one line. The line that separates the two properties seems to be some issues regarding setback. Also, we have a concern with the location of the fence and the plantings, and we'd like to see that line, at least that one line, shot if possible, so we can have a clear-cut definition. If it's a two-foot error on between the two plans and you're down to inches on a setback, we'd like to know that. Talking to the tenants, their concerns are that the lighting from Mr. Tinsman project reflects over into their property. Granted, the trees are high there, but their property is well lit at light at night, one because of the light in the back, and two because of the sign in the front. With respect to noise, there's a great deal of traffic around the property because of the road out front. They tend to live in the back of the house, although the family room is in the front of the house. They do depict a lot of noise from the cars coming and going to the parking lot, particularly in the early morning and late evening hours, which I think Mr. Tinsman, being the owner of the business, is putting in his hours doing that. So we'd like to see some screening. We have some thoughts on that. Currently, the fence, as we look at it, the trees that are there are very tall, spruce sort of trees. I'm not sure exactly what type. And as those tend to get older, the lower branches die. And between the ground and the lower branches is probably 8 to 10 feet that's open and visible. That makes the abutting property very visible. Looking at that, when Tom did his initial plan, we were talking about rhododendrons and things, and I have rhododendrons around my house that are 8 to 10 feet tall. We were thinking something along that diameter that would fill in those gaps rather than the 18-inch ones that are there. It'll take a long time for the ones that Tom planted to provide the screening that we'd like to see, so I think the fence ought to be extended to, as I looked at it, it looks like 20 or 30 feet between where the largest hole is. That should provide a little buffer from the lights and some of the noise. We'd like some additional plantings along there to absorb any noise that we could, and also shield the property from the light. We'd like something done with the front sign. It's very bright. It sort of detracts from the residential use of the Riche property. I pointed out in my letter, I had some thoughts on that. Tom and I have talked about it. He thought of strategically placing a very bushy tree to block that. Looking at the site, that looks a little difficult to do because the most light tends to come into the living room part of the house, and the sign is very open there. So maybe screening of the sign right up front. We prefer to see removal of the sign entirely, but to the extent that that would be an economic burden on Mr. Tinsman, we're willing to be reasonable. The other thing would maybe be some sort of timing mechanism that would turn the bright lights off at an early hour in the evening. The plantings that are there, if they are to be left, certainly need to be beefed up. And then the final issue, my letter's a little old now. I can't recall everything that I wrote. But we are concerned, you know, I think Tom had good intentions and he did get busy. However, it took 2 years to install the improvements that he received at the Zoning Board of Approvals or Appeals. We'd like to see something put in place to make sure that anything's approved is done in a more timely fashion. I submitted one letter with my November 12th letter. I previously, before that, called Ernie or Jerry at least 2 to 3 times and then wrote the letter out of frustration because nothing was happening. That's my comment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ward.
Thank you.
Are there any other members of the public that would like to address the board? Is there any other public comment? Seeing and hearing none, I formally close the public hearing. I guess to start the site plan review, I'd like to invite Mr. Tinsman back to the podium if he wishes. I guess initially to address any comments from the public hearing, either just in general or item by item. After that, I'd like to open it up to the planning board for discussion and questions.
Okay. Thank you. First of all, about the sign issue, I think that's come up every time we've met on anything to do with my property. I've met with Randy on a couple of occasions. Basically, I guess we talked on the phone. We haven't had a chance to get together yet. One of the things that I'm doing to make the sign a little less obtrusive to the properties around me is to take the top part of the sign and make it have a dark blue background instead of a light color, which should throw off a lot less light. That's quite a bit of the top area there. Randy and I also talked about potentially planting some type of an evergreen bush in direct sight view from the house next door to the sign. Currently, we shut the sign off at about 11 o'clock at night. It goes on in the afternoon when it gets dark. So, you know, we're trying to comply with that issue there. In terms of the buffering between the two properties, it is going to take a while for those rhododendrons to grow up and fill in that space completely. I don't think it's 8 to 10 feet high, as stated. I know my van, when I drive in the morning, does hit some of the branches that need to be trimmed back on the driveway side, and that's substantially less than 10 feet. And I'd be willing to talk to the people next door about putting some more things up there. I'm not sure how the town sees these issues, but I've already spent quite a few $100s on putting bufferings up. It is a business zone that I own, and I'd welcome any participation on the neighbors' behalf that anything that they would like to plant in the future would like to see some participation with that. They seem to be having most of the problems. We're not bothered that much by the people next door. As far as the survey goes, everything that has been put in there, the fence, the plantings, have been put inside the property lines. There is no conflict of property line. I see that as a delay of trying to delay a project. I don't see it as a necessary item. There is a pin that was located, that was used to make sure that everything was put inside my property line. So I have, in fact, lost usable space by trying to be sensitive to property lines. I would like to get a clarification on section of fence, whether it means one more section, two more, whatever. I do have another section of fence that I could put up if that's what's required. I saw the letter that came to me and the board that said a section of fence, and I thought I had complied with that, but I'd certainly put up another one if it's one more section, whatever's needed to comply with the original site plan. As far as this site plan review goes, there isn't anything that I'm aware of that's going to be done on the outside that's going to be noticed by anybody. It's all interior renovation, so there isn't really going to be anything on this site plan that's that's going to change the exterior. The sign is placed where it was on the original plan. The plantings have now been put in. I'm trying to be sensitive to the needs of the abutters and would continue to feel that way.
Excuse me, Mr. Tinsman, does the pin that you referred to with respect to the survey show up on the site plan that we have? I don't see it anywhere.
It's the...
I see a reference to a pin oak, but not a pin.
No, there was a pin there.
I couldn't find any pins found on the plan.
It was actually it wasn't a metal pin, it was a granite
monument
in the ground.
But I don't see any reference to that on the plan either.
Well, I'm not sure if it's on or not, but it's out there in the ground, and that's what I use to measure everything.
Is that granite monument mentioned in the legal description?
No. I don't think so.
I'll wait for Janet. Do you have other questions?
No, go ahead.
Okay, any other questions? Stephen?
Yeah, where is the monument? Which point is that marking? In the front, on the right-of-way side, or in the back?
It's on the property line between my property and the Wrights property, back on the school end of the property.
So on the back corner?
Yes.
Mr. Tinsman, in order to draw a line, you need two reference points. Is there more than one monument out there?
I'm not sure what the surveyor found when he went out there. This plan was put together by an engineer, and that's not my field. I don't really know.
I was going to ask you which corner it was in, but I don't even on the plan see a north-south direction. But knowing the direction is the Route 77 runs north-south there. I guess we're trying to get some...
On the western side of the property line.
Along the fence, or is it actually a corner post, corner of a pin?
You know where the high school parking lot is?
Mm-hmm. It says Cape Elizabeth High School.
It's on that corner to the west, southwest corner.
Southwest corner.
Chairman, could I ask a question regarding the survey business?
Sure.
When Maureen was going over the items that we had requested to be submitted in order to deem this complete, she mentioned that the property line survey, which is the latter part of the fourth condition, I'll read the whole one, a copy of the deed indicating your title to the property and a property line survey indicating property line bearings on the site plan. I thought Maureen indicated that what we received on the deed, which did have meets and bounds and a bearing description, agreed with what we had on the plan, but it's not on the plan before me. I have absolutely no description at all on the face of the plan.
When the board was discussing that condition, there wasn't clear agreement on exactly whether a survey was being required, and as I remember this discussion, the statement was made that if there was a sufficient legal description of the property that perhaps a survey would not be needed. The legal description matches the length of the property lines at 210 feet and I believe 160. Those lengths are specifically cited in the legal description. And because there are meets and bounds in the legal description and the length of the property line matches the lengths that are depicted on the site plan, I took that as sufficient, I from what I understood of what the board had asked for. Typically, on projects, the board does request a full survey, and I would recommend that, but In this case, I didn't understand the board to want a full survey if the legal description was sufficient.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions, Steve? Judith?
I was going to add, I think that the same thing I find troublesome is the survey, particularly if there's any conflict apparently about the property line, because it's really close and it's an issue because it's on a zoning, a zone change. I could see where a surveyor would be hesitant to put courses and bearings on a drawing where he hadn't done them. So if they're in the legal description but they're not on here, I'm not surprised that the surveyor or whoever drew this didn't put them on there, because it would imply something along the lines that he actually had taken those bearings. But I feel strongly that, number one, that property line at the minimum should be determined by a licensed surveyor, mm-hmm. if not a whole boundary survey of the property. With one monument, it's really difficult. I have a problem with it.
Judy?
Is the boundary between Mr. Tinsman's property and Mrs. Reisch's property the boundary between the BA and the RC zone?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Then something that we're not even talking about, but it looks to me in the zoning ordinance under section 19-2-11, a buffer area is required.
Yes.
And we're not even talking in terms of that requirement between districts.
It's on page 25. I have it open to that page here, and other board members should take a read through that section. Pertaining to buffer areas is the title of that section.
I, for one, feel uncomfortable feeling like we're moving toward any type of final action on this tonight. I certainly would like to keep discussing it for Mr. Tinsman's benefit to see where we're going and how we can resolve this. But given the concerns, given the concerns of the abutter, I would like to talk about certain things like hours of operation and lighting and so forth, and hope we can direct the applicant to go back and clean this up.
I'd also like to suggest that we can reconsider our vote to consider this application complete, because I don't think it is at this point, because of the lack of survey information.
Maureen, can you address the person?
When the board makes a determination of completeness, that does not restrict it from requesting additional information as the review progresses.
But I guess what I'm saying is that our very specific, maybe it's a legalistic point, but the condition D of what was required earlier was a property line survey indicating property line bearings on the site plan, and I don't see that, nor any indication, and I would not consider the description in the deed to be sufficient because we don't know where it starts from, which is the whole point of a boundary survey.
Any other questions, comments? I think what I hear coming around is that this is an issue that we need to take step by step. I don't totally disagree with you, Janet, on the issue of completeness. My sense of completeness is the board votes, say, what we have before us, we have simply deemed as complete. This is what the applicant is going to bring before us. We are going to base our decision. Doesn't mean we can't make conditions outside of those items brought to us. It does not mean that, and correct me if I'm wrong, Maureen, that we can't demand more detailed information.
No, I don't disagree with that, Mr. Chairman. I think the whole idea of deeming an application complete is that the board has before it, if the application is complete, a sufficient foundation and floor of information on which to proceed to more technical issues, and if we're still not sure where the property line is, it's a little hard to go forward and talk about other issues. But I don't mean to stand on ceremony on this one.
Wasn't planned. But your point's well taken. It does certainly seem to be a focus of concern of the board. Number one, that there are conditions that are placed along this boundary. Number two, that it is a boundary between two different zones. And it seems to be quite clear in the ordinance that there are requirements how that boundary is specifically between zones is treated. As I heard the spokesperson at the public hearing, I have concerns for, and there are the reason for the ordinance and the section under buffer areas addresses some of those issues. There's also the reality that a residential home beside a business area has some effects of a business area simply by proximity to that. It's fully in the intent of our ordinance and our comprehensive plan to buffer those contradicting uses. The sign seems to be an issue. The brightness signs have been an issue here in this town for the last 2 or 3 years. What Mr. Tinsman it seems to be proposing, that it, from just a scale rule, it looks like it's about a 7-foot high sign, and the top 3 feet of it are going to be a darkened lens on a backlit sign, which may be an improvement. I think we need to spend some time on the buffer area and how we might improve that as it affects the residential area. Placing that too close to the sign becomes a safety issue. Site distance certainly becomes a business issue with Mr. Tinsman. As to the visibility of the sign, we're looking for a compromise between the two zones. I guess lastly, the issue of surveying that one line, I don't know technically, maybe Judith, you can shed more light on it, the feasibility of simply surveying one line, whether that's something that a surveyor will sign his name and stamp to on a typical basis.
From my experience, and I'm not a surveyor, but I do deal with them quite a bit. I believe the high school has been surveyed. You have Route 77, which I believe has also been surveyed by means of the DOT and the highway taking. There are surveys on file, not necessarily in the registry, but in the surveyor's offices. So you have, I would say it would not be a difficult survey to produce one, because there are other records. The highway survey would have a great deal to add, particularly to the front. The front, because in order to do the highway taking, they have to determine exactly who owns, and they really do set up the property lines at that point. I don't believe that it would be tremendously onerous to have someone do it. I'm not talking, you know, I would be surprised if it were, I'm not even going to say, let's get in trouble. But there's information there. You're not asking about surveying something that has never seen anyone look at it before.
No, and I agree with that. What is the intent on getting that line? What is the dispute? I don't understand that.
I would say the dispute, as far as I'm concerned, is that, number one, you are on a zone change. Number two, as far as I'm concerned, your neighbor has expressed some concern about the buffering. The zoning ordinance requires 25 feet of buffering when you have that. If there's any question about where the property line is, it really is going to make a lot of difference to this. There's not that much frontage, particularly between the driveway and the abutter's land. If there's a swing of 2 or 3 feet, either one way or the other.
But I guess the thing I don't understand, there are no changes taking place in that area. There is nothing that's going to be happening. Everything that's happening on my request is inside the building. nothing outside.
Okay, but we have at this time, as I understand it, certainly the opportunity, even though these things may have been in existence for 200 years the way they are, we have the opportunity when you come for site plan review to look at the whole thing all over again. We look at the use, we look at the way it's set up. I have a question particularly regarding the abutter with the type of use change. You're going to have all the same real estate use you had, plus more. And now what had been before probably not too bad. Most of your real estate office work was done during the day. You didn't have a lot of cars going in, not that much traffic, becomes something different. And it, frankly, when you come back, as far as I'm concerned, when you come back for site plan review on another project, you open the whole can of worms all over again.
I would just add to that, you know, you asked why. Just a few of the things is I still don't feel it would resolve the offset of the driveway to the property line. I think that if it's not now an important issue, it can be. We have a discrepancy in the distance between the setback of the sideline of the house and the boundary line between this version here and your amended version here of just a couple of feet, but it's a case of which line is it. The buffering is going to be a key issue, and if we don't know where that line is, how do we control where the buffering is placed? I just see that as a response, as a responsibility of running a business in that location. The key boundary to your business location is this one boundary that buffers a residential use, a different use. John?
And with all due respect, Mr. Tinsman, although you are not planning any construction in the area, I would like to echo what Judith Kane said, which is that the significant change in use would be of concern to the planning board, and I think that's why we're taking a serious look at the project overall rather than just simply what is happening in the downstairs of the building itself.
Other comments, or how would the board like to proceed at this point? Judy?
I, for one, would like to let Mr. Tinsman know of some of the concerns I have and perhaps the other board members, because I think it's often unfair to an applicant if we do send him away right now saying, could you correct the survey, and he comes back next meeting and we say, oh, by the way, X, Y, and Z should be done, and then he comes back in February. Mm. So I think probably a few of us have various issues. Maybe they're all echoing each other, but I would like to let him know what my concerns are now.
Okay, why don't we just try to be concise in those concerns, list those concerns, and we'll try to get a consensus of the board as we go down through the... Judy, why don't you start?
Okay, this is probably in no order because I've got notes all over the place. I am concerned about the sign. I don't know the history of this project, Mr. Tinsman. I don't know what you discussed with the ZBA and the life of the sign and the depreciation schedule. I can certainly see, though, that the brightness is an issue, and I would want to know exactly how that's going to be affected. You're telling me you're going to darken the upper part. Doesn't mean a lot to me. But if you come back with a concrete proposal, or if you are proposing some sort of evergreen screening where that would be, perhaps if there's additional fencing, that would solve that problem. But more information on the sign. The hours of operation do concern me, something brought up in Mr. Blake's letter. I believe we do have authority to limit hours of operation and uses. Is that correct? Because I can see it's certainly a different type of clientele using this business as opposed to your real estate office, and nothing against young teenage boys, but I can see them using the business, perhaps congregating in the parking lot. I'd like to get a sense of what hours of operation you're proposing. I would like you to think hard about how you might propose to buffer the property given the requirement to buffer between the zone changes. Perhaps the simplest way would be a fence that I think it was a 5-foot minimum height, and you'd probably have to drop it down for site distance near the very front, but I would look for a lot more buffering than currently is there. Let's see if I have any other. I was concerned with the parking lot before. I'm not particularly concerned with it now, unless other board members are. I think that's it for me right now.
Janet, anything to add to that?
The only thing that I would add is that the imprecision of the number of parking spaces disturbs me. We have a report that says there are 10 parking spaces. Mr. Tinsman represents orally tonight that there are 15. I would like very much to see something that's simply striped and so that I can count them and see that the parking spaces are there. I guess I don't, I would like to see more, as much precision as possible. Other than that, I don't believe I have any other comments, but I understand that my neighbor may have one.
Judy?
I just missed one thing. We talked, it had been brought up, the issue of the lighting with
yes.
some spillover, and wondered what could be done perhaps to shield that glare, whether it's a device on the light or additional buffering.
Would you like, okay, I guess that one needs to be, are you asking for narrative or are you asking for depiction on the plan itself for radius?
I think a proposal to deal with that. If it's, I'm very sensitive with this issue, the abutting zones, and clearly Mr. Tinsman cannot do what the ordinance wants with respect to buffering. There just is not the distance, and there was a zone change mm-hmm. made at some point, and that's not his fault or specifically his problem. But I think he should do it as much as he can to shield that residential use given the configuration now, which may be a shielding device on the lot.
I think that's a real point. And what Judy's referring to in section 19.2.11, where it says there's just not that distance. The ordinance reads that no building should be erected or any new use permitted in the business districts A, B, C, and C, where a district abuts a residence district, unless a buffer strip of land not less than 25 feet in depth shall be left to remain in its natural state to ensure the business district. It goes on. We talked about this at the first 1989 site plan approval, and that was the reason for some specific reference to filling in the under branch area. At that time, those conditions evidently were not specific enough of how high the size of those plants. I certainly have nothing. I think rhododendrons would be beautiful in that area. Yes, then they do grow. I just don't, you know, we come up against this issue time and time again, and it seems to be a real issue in this town between abutting uses and even abutting densities, where we take special strides to make sure that there's as little influence from one to another.
Excuse me,
Janet,
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to add one other
mm-hmm.
thing, and that is with respect to the buffering, I'd like to be sensitive to the noise issue and see if there is something that we can do to minimize that in addition to the site distances.
Okay. Judith, do you have anything to add?
I'm trying to decide what
I'm okay. Stephen?
Tom, when you come back, are you going to have a specific hours that you are proposing to be open? And also, it seems to me with all the problems with the sign, it seems it might make sense at this time before a change is made to compare the cost of having maybe a front-lit sign created that would solve a lot of problems and compare that cost to changing the dishes on the backlit sign. I would be interested in seeing if that could be done.
Judith?
I will add only this, which I think that's probably been made before. I would like to see you come back with an aggressive buffering plan
I think one of the things that is sort of resting uneasily with me is the fact that the buffering that was supposed to go in 2 years ago didn't get in until this year. I mean, they would have been that much bigger now. I know you're busy, my heavens, we've all got busy lives, but I'd like to see you take that really very seriously and have, as I said, just aggressive big bushes, this, that, or whatever you need to do. Fences is a possibility as well, and have some definitive statement about the property line. And I would just call a surveyor and ask if they can do it.
Tim? Certainly don't want to leave our non-voting member out. I didn't mean to wake you up. Sorry. I wasn't expecting that, were you? Any further? Okay. Maureen?
I guess I have a question, just to clarify. As I have my list here right now, there is no request for any additional survey information.
I haven't offered mine yet.
Okay.
Was there anything else? I did it in my list, didn't it? And I think you alluded to...
I would say that I would want, at the minimum, that one property line defined by a surveyor. And it could be... I won't necessarily say that I'll just become adamantly against it if I don't see a whole survey. But, I mean, even a mortgage inspection plan that some of these people are doing... for $150 or so, substantially very good. I mean, they really would have enough to make me feel comfortable if there were some references to something. Well, this just looks like it was done by a I'm not sure. Lighthouse Landscaping or some whatever.
I guess I'd just like to summarize and go down and make sure that it's real clear to you. I think the tone of what the board is saying is twofold. Number two, I think we all wish that the site plan approval that was granted 2 years ago, that everything had been completed before it was brought here, so we'd have a more comfortable level of confidence that these would be completed, or at least a benchmark from where we're working. There are numbers of issues here that we have raised that stem from what we see and have deemed as the complete package that we need as improvements. And it seems to be the consensus of the board that those issues, we need these better defined and better spelled out for us, either narratively or graphically, for us to vote on the site plan approval. And I'll just go down through the sign. I think you have got halfway there with the drawing that you have. You show it. It seems to be drawn to scale. It is a key issue, both from the buffering zone change issue to the brightness of the sign issue. If you could just be more specific, what color will that background be? You might even state specifically how much of the sign is going to be darkened versus what it is now, so we can have some sense of what the diminishing effect of darkening the lens might be. One of the board members mentioned perhaps looking at the feasibility of a front-lit versus a backlit sign. That's strictly a business decision on your part, I would assume. The hours of use, I heard mentioned two or three times. While the area in use has not changed, the type of use is different, and it may attract different hours of use and different clientele. I think you need to give us comfortable parameters that you're going to work by. The survey, it seems to be the consensus of the board that one line, we need to have a strong definition. And it seems to be from what we have that is not an extraordinary request, that one line is shot. I would like to add to that I recommend that you just show the distance of offset from that line at the right-of-way to the driveway itself. where it hits the right-of-way.
When you say right-of-way, do you mean the road?
Yes, the municipal right-of-way, or state right-of-way, I'm sorry, hit that point. The lighting issue, you can choose to either show that on the plan itself, where the lighting from the building will be contained in a certain arc of light, a certain distance away, showing that it's going to prevent lighting intrusion on the neighboring residential use. And lastly, echoed by everybody on the board, is the buffering issue. It seems to be a consensus that what is now there and may have only been there for a couple of weeks is still not sufficient to buffer between these two zones, these two uses. I sense the consensus of the board is that I'm going to ask you to come back with a proposal, and I would urge you to certainly not take away those rhododendrons, but there must be visually a way to, even temporarily with evergreen shrubs, fill in those holes until the rhododendron can fill in that blank space.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, could we also have some more clear direction from Ernie McVane about what, if any, fencing still needs to be provided?
I would add that to the list. So not to make the burden more extensive, but so that there's something definite, that there's a distance in it. If we have a distance from the town right-of-way, a measurement back from the from the right-of-way to where the end of the fence should be, you'll know. It won't be a case of, was it one length or 6 foot length or 8 foot length or whatever. What's the town talking about? It's a definite point along that line. Did I miss anything, board members? Judy?
Janet had brought up the issue of marking the parking spaces. Right now, I did go by today, and there are separate parking signs. It looks like 15 signs in front of each space on a fence. I don't know if the board is interested in more, but that was brought up as an issue to address.
Is the surface still gravel?
Yes.
I guess I might ask, what how else could we delineate the spaces other than by signs?
And it does say that the previous site plan approval required the parking spaces to be marked in some way, so I guess
I remember we talked a little bit about that. If we left it a gravel site, that it was better for to decrease actual runoff to the high school. It was less expensive, but it's pretty tough to paint gravel. You have to keep sure those rocks stay the right side up all the time and don't move around.
Orange paint works well, though.
Okay. Paint all the way around all sides of the rock.
Okay.
Okay. Anything else? I take it that it sounds like, and I conferred just briefly with Maureen, maybe the wishes of the board to table this with this request, sending the applicant back for a month or whatever he deems to be a period of time reasonable to finish those items that we've requested. I would just urge the board, if that is what's going to be sufficient for you to make a decision, let's tell the applicant that now so he doesn't come back and say, well, oh yeah, by the way, one or two more things. Tim?
Did anyone want to discuss the proposed condition for performance guarantee?
I think, number one, that was in our notes. Number two, it's in the ordinance in section 11, 19.2.11, under buffer areas of the town. May ensure compliance with these provisions by appropriate bond.
What would appropriate bond be?
I'll defer that to Maureen.
Under our current ordinance, most of the provisions are in the subdivision ordinance, but there is a line there that also makes them apply to site plan. I believe if the board were to make it a condition of approval that the applicant submit some kind of performance guarantee, that we would use the guidelines in the subdivision ordinance to make sure that an appropriate bond was submitted. That would be probably, usually in smaller projects, people prefer to establish an escrow account rather than a letter of credit. and the town attorney and town manager would be reviewing those to see that they have appropriate language about withdrawals and release of money and the other factors you have to have in any one of those agreements.
I do appreciate Mr. Eikenberg bringing up the point, though, because I certainly do intend to request at this point to have a performance guarantee for all of the items that are to be performed in light of the history with this particular applicant.
Maureen, I might ask, how could the applicant prepare for next, when they might appear again next month or whenever that is, appropriately for that? In anticipation of a bond or a performance guarantee?
Typically, the applicant must submit an estimate of the improvements so that you can rely on an amount that the guarantee is supposed to be, an amount of the guarantee. In addition, if for example, the guarantee were to be an escrow account, typically a letter will go along with the escrow that cites the terms of the agreement for how long the applicant has to complete the improvements, when the money can be drawn by the town, how the money can be released back to the applicant. So I would recommend that when the applicant comes back with a revised site plan, that he also make an attempt to estimate the cost of the improvements on that site plan and also include a draft escrow account. If the board were concerned about bringing the applicant back for a further meeting beyond next month, there could be a condition on any proposed approval that the final language in the escrow account agreement be approved by the town attorney and that the final amount of the performance guarantee be approved by the town engineer.
I'd also like to see, we have our January meeting is the 21st. What would the applicant's deadline be for submitting further information?
It would be the first Friday in January. I believe that's January 3rd.
And we're facing the Christmas season here. I don't know how difficult it will be to complete the requirements that we're suggesting. I suppose what I'm saying is we may want to try to do something for 60 days rather than 30 days and have it be in the applicant's discretion as to whether the applicant wants to come back in January or February.
The board could make a tabling motion to a specific meeting, say the February meeting, and if the applicant were willing to come back in January, there would be nothing to prevent him from doing so.
Judith?
I think that makes a lot of sense.
To a larger period of time.
Yes.
Longer period of time.
It is really, when you think it's the 3rd of January.
Right around the corner.
It's right around the corner.
Any comment from the applicant? directions clear? Any comments?
I mean, in terms of submitting materials for the next meeting,
yeah.
Normally it's January 3rd.
Right.
Are you considering
what the board seems to be saying is that seems to be a real short period of time for the list of things that what we sounds like we may be doing is extending the tabling until a February meeting instead of a certain number of days to the February meeting. If you have it all done by the January meeting cutoff time, certainly we'd love to review it at that time. We're just giving you that larger time span to get that in.
Would you consider extending the January 3rd period 1 week longer?
I'd defer that.
No, I don't think so. We've been through that one before, and yeah. The deadline is based on ability to gather the information and get it distributed to all of us and have us have time to consider it. So I think that's the difficult part.
We did try that once before, and it was just within the last year, and it is difficult, believe it or not, to get that all assembled and out to all of us in time for us to get the chance to review before we attend this meeting. So I guess you know, we found it didn't work before, so I'd urge you to either try to meet that deadline or we'll go into the February meeting. Any other comments? Questions? Judy?
Just a general comment to Mr. Tinsman. Since this is now a
accepted use. I, you know, wish you luck in doing this. I have nothing against it or in the site particularly, since it is already a business use. And I would urge you, since you seem to be somewhat confused as to why the board is asking for certain things when there's a limited change of use in your mind, is to please contact Maureen if in doubt, or to go over what we're asking, so that when you do come here, that we don't feel like we have to send you back again. I'd love to look at this complete and be able to make a decision on it.
Okay, any other comments, discussion? None appearing. Do I hear a motion? I might urge you to utilize the motion in our staff presentation, and perhaps change that to table where it says granted. Follow the bouncing ball, please.
I'm not sure I can follow the directions of the chairman, but I believe that I am capable of making a motion.
I'm
so
sorry.
I would like to. I would like to move that we table the application of Mr. Tensman for the fitness center until the regularly scheduled board meeting in February, with the understanding that if Mr. Tensman feels he is able to meet the qualifications that we've set forth tonight, that he certainly is free to come back to the January meeting, provided that he meets the January 3rd deadline for submitting materials for that meeting.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? I take that motion, Maureen, sufficiently implies the discussion.
I can also be more specific about the conditions with a little help from a friend. Would you like to be more specific?
Do you think that they should be part of
let's,
the motion?
Let's whatever. I don't know
that we need to make it a real long motion, as long as it's reasonably implied that the discussion is the reason for the tabling.
I feel in the discussion the board has had that it's clear from the minutes and from my notes. I understand what you're asking for, and I'll be able to work with the applicant to get these things completed.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? None appearing. All those in favor of the motion as stated, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. Hope to see you back within the next 2 months. Thanks. That is the last item of business on our regularly scheduled agenda. Is there any other new business to appear? Any other business to appear? Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Seconded. Moved and seconded. All those in favor? Meeting is adjourned.
What is this, Maureen?